Hello, my name is Ioannis Arkoudis. I will present you the work with title MFS for electromagnetic scattering by a layered chiral object. It has been done in collaboration with Professor Halikias, Professor Rupa, and Dr. Joy. Starting with a brief introduction to the term chirality, the word chiral is derived by the Greek word here, which means hand. It was introduced by Lord Kelvin in order to describe structural forms that are non-superimposable to their mirror image. Chirality can be met widely in nature, from microscopic level with biomolecules, to macroscopic level with helical goat horns, sea cells, up to spiral galaxies. Chirality, of course, can also be met in various areas of science, such as mathematics, where we have the most characteristic chiral structure being the helix, or the left-handed, right-handed trefoil knot in knot theory. In physics, we have chirality in electromagnetic wave propagation as hardness, which is wave polarization in terms of helicity. In these two gifts, we see a left circularly polarized and a right circularly polarized propagating wave, as defined from the point source view, according to the IEA. Chiral materials also present optical activity, which is rotation of polarization, which is the rotation of the plane of polarization as it travels through a chiral material, an optically active material. In chemistry, we have chirality mostly on molecular level with enantiomers, such as the biomolecules presented previously. The same goes for biology. The biomolecules, the enantiomers, have different physiological effect, the left-handed from the right-handed, leading to also different physiological effects in drugs. An example, a characteristic example is the drug thalidomide, which is a racemic mixture, meaning that it consists of equal parts of enantiomers. It was prescribed in late 50s, early 60s to pregnant women as an anti-nausea agent, but even though the right-handed enantiomer had the desired anti-nausea effects, the left-handed had teratogenic effects, leading to the defect of implants. This signified the role of chirality in various areas of science and the development of chiral drugs. A more recent example of chirality and its application are the artificial chiral metamaterials, which are man-made materials with enhanced chirality. This enhanced chirality leads to various interesting effects, such as vibration attenuation, sound absorption, electromagnetic stealth, and thermal isolation, zero thermal expansion. The development of chiral metamaterials throughout the years can be seen in this figure, starting from the theoretical point of view up to today's chiral flexible electronics. Two examples of chiral metamaterials can be seen here: a compression to yeast material and a cellular solid with amplified oxidative effects. Concerning the effect of chirality to electromagnetic wave propagation, as we know, the electromagnetic wave propagation is governed by the system of Maxwell equations. In the present work, we consider time harmonic dependence, and therefore we have the time harmonic Maxwell equations. Moreover, we need a set of constitutive relations that characterize the medium of propagation, and in the present work, we take the Drude-Born-Fedorov constitutive relations that characterize a linear homogeneous isotropic chiral medium of chirality beta, electric permittivity epsilon, magnetic permeability mu. Applying these constitutive relations to the time harmonic Maxwell equations, we obtain the corresponding modified time harmonic Maxwell equations for chiral media. For the formulation of our scattering problem, we consider a bounded region D, which is called the scatterer, the unbounded region outside the scatterer, which is denoted with D0, and the surface of the scatterer denoted with S0. Since we consider the scatterer to be layered, Its interior is divided by means of closed and non-intersected penetrable smooth surfaces, SJ, each one enclosing the next one, leading to the development of layers, each one being occupied by homogeneous isotropic chiral material. We take a time harmonic plane electromagnetic wave that propagates in the unbounded region D0 to be incident upon the surface S0 of the scatterer, resulting a scattered electromagnetic field as well as n transmitted electromagnetic fields, each one propagating in its corresponding layer DJ. With the vectors PL and PR, we will denote the polarization of the LCP part and the RCP part of the wave. And with D hat L and D hat R, we will denote the direction of propagation of the LCP and the RCP part, respectively. Since we work mainly with the electric field, the results can be extended accordingly for the magnetic field, the results that we will present. Therefore, we can eliminate from the system of time harmonic Maxwell equations the magnetic field in order to obtain the second order time harmonic Maxwell equations for chiral media given by equation 7 and 8. Since every surface is considered to be penetrable, on the surface S0, the outer surface, we have the non-homogeneous transmission conditions 9 and 10, while on the rest of the surfaces, we have the homogeneous transmission 11 and 12 accordingly. Finally, the scattered field satisfies the radiation condition, the Silver-Müller, the modified Silver-Müller radiation condition for chiral media at infinity, which describes its decaying character and ensures the well-posedness of our problem. One of our main tools is the dyadic fundamental solution of the second-order equations, which also consists of an LCP and RCP part with formula 16 and 17. The scatter field takes its asymptotic form 18 at infinity, where the superscripts infinity denote the LCP and RCP far field patterns respectively. And with formula 19, we have the scattering cross sections of the LCP and RCP scattering cross sections, which describe the energy extracted from the incidence in terms of in the form of radiation. The vector spaces in which we mainly work are the tangential vector spaces, since we will work mainly on the surfaces. And therefore, we consider the Hilbert spaces of the Hilbert space of square integrable tangential vector fields equipped with the corresponding inner product induced norm and its products. Another one of our tools are the vector valued potentials, the surface vector valued potentials, defined from the formulas 24 and 25. For each layer, they are solutions of the corresponding chiral equation of the layer, and they have many regularity properties and jump relations on the surface on which they are not defined. And for these regularity properties, we refer to our previous published work. Now we can proceed to the method. The method of fundamental solution is a meshless numerical technique in order to approximate the sought-for solution of elliptic boundary value problems when the fundamental solution is known. Specifically, we want to approximate the sought-for solution by finite linear combinations in terms of the dyadic fundamental solution B, for singularities placed outside the domain of the solution, and specifically we consider them uniformly distributed on auxiliary surfaces. The unknown vector coefficients can be determined by the boundary condition, but we will see why is that later. This finite linear combination due to linearity satisfy the corresponding chiral equations of the layer they belong. And we want to prove that the approximation of the solution by this finite linear combination is reduced to the approximation of the boundary data by appropriately constructed systems of functions. To this end, we construct the systems of functions in terms of the functions 28 and 29, in terms of the tangential components of the columns of the dyadic fundamental solution, for densely distributed singularity points on the auxiliary surface. We will prove some density results for this system of vector functions. Starting with the completeness, we have that the jth system is complete on the product space, on the Hilbert space of the surface Sj. For the proof, we have a sketch where we consider an arbitrary vector field X in this product space, and we will take the inner product to be equal to zero. We want to show that the vector X will vanish. Due to the density of the singularity points on their corresponding auxiliary surfaces, there's reciprocity relations for the dyadic fundamental solution, and after manipulation calculations, we can write these inner product equations in terms of our defined vector potentials, as can be seen in equations 32 and 33. Therefore, based on these equations, we define these auxiliary vector valued functions, which satisfy, since they are linear combination of the vector potentials, appropriately constructed auxiliary scattering problems, leading to their vanishing in their whole domain of definition. And from the jump relations of these vector valued potentials on the surface Sj, where they present the singularities, we obtain the wanted result that J equals to H equals to zero on the surface Sj. For a more analytic proof, the steps of this proof, we refer to our published work. For the linear independence, again, the Jth system is linear independent on the surface Sj. We take a finite, an arbitrary finite linear combination of them, and we will prove that the coefficients are equal to zero if the linear combination is equal to zero. Again, we define appropriately constructed vector valued functions, u plus and u minus, which now are defined everywhere except a finite set of points. They are analytic in the whole domain of definition due to the analyticity of the vector valued potentials. And from relation 36, it can be seen that they satisfy a homogeneous transmission problem, auxiliary transmission problem on the surface Sj of the scatterer, leading to their vanishing, and due to analyticity, to their vanishing in their whole domain of definition, except the singularity points. Then, by using three auxiliary lemmas for the dyadic fundamental solution, which we have proven in our reference work, we immediately take that the vector coefficients vanish, leading to the linearly independence of the system on Sj. For the MFS approximation of the far field data, as we mentioned previously, we have the electric far field patterns and the scattering cross section. For the MFS approximation of the electric far field patterns, we simply take the MFS approximation of the scatter field, and we use asymptotic analysis on the dyadic B in order to obtain formula 39. Based on this formula, we can also obtain the MFS approximation of the scattering cross section given in 40. From all the previous results, we can now obtain our desired theorem, which states that if we take these finite linear combinations, then the approximation of the solution is reduced to the approximation of the boundary data, which can be done arbitrarily well, and the same follows for the far field data. The proof is basically the proof is derived from the theorems of linear independence and completeness, together with the dependence of the solution to the boundary data, applying Cauchy-Schwarz inequality and using the regularity properties of the boundary integral operators. Okay, so we saw that the approximation of the solution is reduced to the approximation of the boundary data. This in practice can be done point-wise, meaning that we take that can be done arbitrarily well from finite linear combinations of our constructed systems. In practice, we do this point-wise, meaning that we take finite linear combination of these systems and we apply collocation method, meaning that we consider a finite set of collocation points on the surface S of the scatterer, on the surface SJ, and we apply the transmission conditions on each one of them. This leads us to an algebraic linear system in terms of the unknown vector coefficients in block matrix form with elements seen here.
Yanis, we'll have two more minutes, okay?
Okay. For the numerical results, we consider a simpler case and we use MATLAB. We have the physical parameters of the medium here. We consider an LCP incident in a glucose solution, 20 to 50% in the visible spectrum. We took uniform distributed. Here we have indicatively the uniform distributed points and collocation points. The black points on the white surface and yellow surface are the collocation points, and the red dots are the singularity points on the blue surfaces. We solved the system using MATLAB, then we constructed the MFS approximations and we calculated the degree of circular and degree of linear polarization as defined in this reference work. Here we present the result. We see that as the chirality increases, as we go in the inner layer, the curve starts to smoothen up. We have the corresponding results for the scattering cross sections. And finally, we consider the case where the chirality of the inner layer vanishes, meaning that we have an achiral sphere, multi-layer sphere, embedded in a chiral medium, which a similar model was studied in this reference work, and we see that we obtain pretty similar results. Here is the used bibliography. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Yanis Arkoudis. Very interesting presentation. And please, have any questions?
Hello, can I ask some question?
Yes, yes, of course.
First of all, really so interesting and relevant report. Thank you very much. I wanna ask you. I'm understood from your report that you use some electromagnetic filters. My question, which type of electromagnetic filters were used in your research? Thank you.
Filters or fields?
Filters. I understand it's filters you use it.
We didn't use any filter. We consider a plain electromagnetic wave to be propagating in this chiral medium. And we simply consider the whole resulting field in the outer region to be the scatter field and the transmitted ones to be the other. The filter, a filter if it was applied, since the unbounded region is considered to be infinite, we didn't have any filter in order to polarize the wave or something like that.
Okay, this means you use only MATLAB, like have the mathematical model and like only soft. You not realize this in real research, yes?
I wish, but no.
I wish you good luck. Thank you.
thank you, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. Any more questions? So, Yanis, have you made any calculated estimation of your mathematical model?
Estimation according to real data or these numerical estimates?
Let's say you don't have real data. Yes, on real data, of course. Yeah. Your mathematical method on real data.
We don't have access to real data. Our only estimates are taken via the solution of the system, which we obtain, from which we can derive theoretically some information. Basically, the relative residual we obtain, which, as we see from here, it can also transfer to the approximation of the solution. This estimate was of the order 10 to the minus 9.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The error, if you consider that an estimate.
Yes, excellent. Very nice. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Arkoudis. Very nice. Thank you very much. So, any more questions we have, please? Okay. So let's continue with